is SportsCenter's Top 10 Games.
In case you were wondering who was singing, that was the late Freddie Mercury from the band Queen. Welcome to SportsCenter's Top 10 Games of 2001. I'm Dan Patrick, along with Rich Eisen.
Ahead, we will rock you with the best comebacks, the most amazing finishes, the most excitement, and best memories we can slam into an hour as we count down our top 10.
And we begin with one of the more improbable finishes of the season in the baseball world. What started out as another easy win for the Seattle Mariners became one for the history books at Jacobs Field. We take you back to August 5th, 2001. This is Mike Kerman doubling in two runs. He had three hits, three RBIs. Seattle built a 14-2 lead after five innings. Holbert Cabrero in the bottom of the seventh drives in two runs. The Indians are still down 14-5. In the eighth, Marty Cordova, a two-run homer, one of four hits by Cordova. And the Indians score four in the eighth, cut the deficit to five. Bottom nine, Einar Diaz, the base knock, brings in two runs with two outs, cuts Seattle's lead to 14-11. Bases loaded, two outs, Omar Vizquel off Kaz Sasaki, Will Cordero, Diaz, and Kenny Lofton score to tie the game at 14 after nine. Bottom of the 11th, still tied at 14. Cabrera, who did not start in the game, ends the game with a broken bat single to left field, brings in Kenny Lofton, and the Indians win it 15-14. Cabrera goes 2-for-5, three RBIs in place of Robbie Alomar. The 12-run deficit ties the record for the largest comeback to a win in a game since 1900. Down 12-0 and 14-2, the Indians storm back to become only the third team to win a game down by 12 runs in the last 101 years. The last time it happened, 1925, when the Philadelphia A's defeated the Indians 17-15. For more on this finish, here's Tim Kirkchin.
The 15,548th game in Indians history may have been the wildest. Cleveland became the third team in history and first since 1925 to win a game that it trailed by 12 runs. The other teams featured Ty Cobb and Mickey Cochran, respectively. The Indians' comeback was even more remarkable since it came against the Mariners, who were 70 games over 500, had baseball's best bullpen, hadn't lost a game this year in which they led by more than three runs, and had never lost a game in which they scored 14 runs.
And there it is, base hit. Back of our Chargers. Here comes Lofton. Here comes the throw. Deep. And Cleveland has won it.
Holbert Cabrera's game-winning hit in the 11th inning was his second hit of the game and the fifth by an Indian who didn't even start. Charlie Manuel sent most of his stars to the bench down 12 runs and faced with the Mariners' vaunted bullpen. Seattle relievers allowed 10 earned runs in 3 2/3 innings. The Seattle bullpen hadn't allowed that many earned runs in its previous 68 innings. Star setup man Jeff Nelson didn't retire a batter, but gave up more runs, too, than he'd allowed in his previous 11 appearances. Star closer Kaz Sasaki blew the save after 14 straight scoreless outings. 29 runs were scored in all, yet Ichiro, who was second in the American League in runs, didn't score a run. 19 players combined for 40 hits, but Robbie Alomar, the AL's third leading hitter, had none. And the game's only error was by 9-time Gold Glover Omar Vizquel. It was 12-0 after three innings. Seattle's Mike Cameron had two doubles, three RBIs, and three at-bats before Cleveland's number 9 hitter, Einar Diaz, ever came to the plate. It was 14-2 after six innings. Then the Indians scored three in the seventh, four in the eighth, and five in the ninth, and one in the 11th to beat a Mariners team that was 105-7 when leading after eight innings. Yogi Berra was right. In baseball, it's never over until it's over.
Thank you, Tim. The Indians' 12-run comeback was by far the largest of the 2001 season. There was only one other comeback from more than a 7-run deficit on September 27th. The Rockies fell behind the Padres 8-0 before winning the game 13-9. This game was at Coors Field, of course.
In the first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs back in April, even the most diehard Red Wings fan had every reason to turn off Game 4 against the Kings with 7 minutes to go in regulation. It was 3-0 Detroit and almost 1 in the morning Detroit time. No doubt said fan choked on the morning coffee while watching SportsCenter or reading the paper. The Wings lost. The Kings won 4-3 in overtime. How in the world did that happen? Well, in case you missed it.
It goes from bad to worse for the LA Kings. They are down 3-0 in this game four of the Western Conference quarter. They've got to go back Saturday to play at the Joe in Detroit.
And so LaPointe will take the penalty. LA will go on the power play with one last chance to try and get back in this game.
Snyder, saw one by LA, shot right on, rebound loose. Send right in!
And now L.A.'s got some life with 6 minutes to go.
And the empty net on the other end, under three to go in the third period.
Well, Andy Murray taking a big risk here. Taking a big risk being on the power play, but of course his power play hasn't had a heck of a lot of success.
Great play, down low, loose, both tied, two chances at it. Shut down by Osgood. It's couple centers, puck loose, and is it in? The Kings think so. You can tell by the reaction, and Mark Fossett's indication, Stumpel gets the goal.
Andy Murray made the right call, pulling his goaltender. He got one extra player on the ice, which really helped his team.
Final minute, regulation. Down low, in front it goes, loose, and score!
And this place is going nuts.
A good coach, you figure every series, every couple of series will steal you victory, and Andy Murray may have done this.
Andy Murray, if they get this win tonight, probably deserves the game puck.
Wide to the left, Tomasco. Chelios Padil, tracked down first, Denmark. At the goal line, there's loose! Belanger scores! This one is over! The Staples Center shocker is complete!
Coming up, some of the best finishes of the year, including a look back at what may have been the most amazing minute in the NFL this season. Also, the Commander-in-Chief's first pitch was a moment to remember from the World Series, but that was just the beginning. We'll relive the drama.
And Shaquille's Lakers were streaking through the playoffs until they got to the finals. We'll remember one of the more shocking NBA final games ever played.
It's the new year, the perfect time to take a new look at Volvo. During the Volvo New Year New Look event, you'll like what you see. The styling, the performance, and surprising savings on the entire line of 2002 Volvos, like the Volvo S40. So see your local Volvo retailer now. Because it should come as no surprise, the Volvo New Year New Look event won't last forever.
This holiday, stay connected to the people who matter most. With the Shared Advantage plan from AT&T Wireless, you'll get unlimited local calling between plan members. So Dad could talk to Mom, Mom could talk to the kids, and the kids could talk to each other as often as they like. Start with two phone lines for $59.99 a month and add up to three more for only $9.99 each. You can also get up to five free phones with nationwide long distance included and plenty of minutes to go around. All for life. Call 1-800-IMAGINE today for a gift that will have the whole family talking.
You can't bring that motorcycle in here, you filthy animal!
At $400 a night, I'll bring whatever I want to my room.
Security! Help me! I've been run over by Mad Mike Jones!
Winter X Games 6 in Aspen begins February 1st on ESPN.
Hi, I'm Brendan Haywood of the Washington Wizards, wishing you a happy holidays and continue to fight for us over there.
Happy holidays to you guys over in Afghanistan. Merry Christmas.
God bless you troops. Come home safe. Thanks for handling one of the biggest jobs that you could ever handle in your life. We love you. Thank you for fighting for our freedom.
The David versus Goliath analogy is used all the time in sports, but there may not have been a more literal example of that contrast than the NBA Finals back in June. Allen Iverson played the role of David, just 6 foot tall, 165 pounds, but the stone in his slingshot was a scoring average of 31 points per game. Shaquille O'Neal obviously was cast as Goliath, 7 foot tall, 320 pounds, leading a team that had won 19 games in a row heading into game one of the finals. Their remarkable showdown is game number 8 in our countdown.
It's the L.A. Lakers, man. You know, they haven't lost a game the whole playoffs. I've been waiting for this opportunity all my life.
Iverson drives, loses the ball. Here's the three ball for Fox. It's good. On the money. Kobe's there on the steal. Got Fox. Fox is open from Iverson. And Fox shoots the layup.
Lakers on a roll.
They jumped out on us.
They got two of the best players in our game, the most dominant player in our game. So they should be the favorites, but Allen really stepped up.
Iverson pull up 18-footer. Good. Here's Iverson. Pump fake on Kobe, step back and nail the fadeaway. Steal by Iverson. Back on Bryant. Easy layup. Here he comes, the three ball. Yes! Allen Iverson, a 30-point first half. Hold on to the coronation, ladies and gentlemen.
Shaquille had a great game. And his energy in the second half is what kept us in that ball game.
Bryant fires a two, misses, and it's shot, slamming it down.
He's so big, catch the ball so low. When he gets it, I mean, what can you do?
Shaq said, bring it on, bring it on. And he turned and slammed it. Shaq was making a turnaround up over Geiger, carrying the load. It's a one-man Lakers team.
Iverson trying to get away from Lou. Tyrone Lou with a steal and a layup by Lou.
I thought they defended him as well as anybody's defended him all year.
With 18 seconds left, I can't get the ball for the last shot. You know, something's wrong.
Back to Snow. He's got to shoot it. He does. It's in the air. Oh, he just missed it. Game one goes to overtime.
We always understand that, you know, we keep fighting, keep playing, you know, keep playing together, and anything can happen.
Lou on the dribble down the lane. Underhand scoop by Lou. Not even close. And the Sixers for the ball. What a terrible shot by Los Angeles. Here's Allen Iverson. Outside the arc. He tees up a three. It's good. And the Sixers have taken the lead.
It was really the knife that wounded us.
Iverson against Tyrone Lou. Baseline right. He backs up. He fires two ball. Got it again. He's way too good. He steps around Lou and drove it. Three to shoot a runner by Eric. It's up. It's good. The snowman delivers.
That was a series. That's what it's all about. You got so many basketball experts. The only guys that know is the guys on the floor.
Our guys just try hard, and This is unexpected, but it's kind of neat.
The Lakers' Game 1 loss to the Sixers was their only loss in the 2001 NBA playoffs. Los Angeles became the first team in the current playoff format to win the title with fewer than two losses. Counting the final eight games of the regular season, LA won 23 of its final 24 games.
Game 7 on the list, September 5th, a brilliant Wednesday night at the U.S. Open. Pete Sampras and Andre Agassi, 11 years after their first matchup there in a quarterfinals matchup to remember. First set, Agassi takes it in a tiebreak. Second set, Sampras storms back in another tiebreak, goes to the net. Pete for the huge winner, and he's pumped. Takes the second set in a tiebreak. Fourth set, Sampras up 2-1. His huge serve has Agassi scrambling. And Pete finishes him off there, and it's time for match point. Agassi only 18 unforced errors on the night, and he goes out in four sets, all in tiebreaks. Sampras, a winner. Next, if we told you in the summer one SEC football game would make the list, how many would have chosen Arkansas at Ole Miss? Can't miss forthcoming.
And we'll take you to the show in October, the World Series. Derek Jeter's home run, the topper, and one of the most dramatic finishes the Fall Classic has ever seen.
Oh, 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 and what would you like, Timmy?
Okay, due to the length of this line and the unbearable constriction of my tights, I'm gonna make this easy for everyone. I'm guessing young Timmy wants America's favorite PC, Adele. And as luck would have it, you can get Timbo here, a complete Dell system with an Intel Pentium 4 processor for just $8.99. And right now, the shipping is free. Plus, every Dell is backed by award-winning service and support. You don't even have to load up the sleigh. Just call or go online, and Dell will help you build the PC that's right for you.
At $8.99, a Dimension desktop with an Intel Pentium 4 processor is the perfect gift for anyone. Call or go online today, and the shipping is free. There's great deals on notebooks, too.
Little dude, you are getting a Dell.
Holiday values made easy. Easy as Dell.
Are you?
Yeah, I'm one of them. What do you want?
Could you pass along a holiday wish list? I've been very good, and I'd like to visit ESPN Studios to meet a SportsCenter anchor. Please?
The Beck's Wish List Sweepstakes lets you and four friends tour SportsCenter and meet an anchor. Log on to ESPN.com contest to enter and watch SportsCenter at 6 and 11.
Little to the left.
Booyah!
She'll definitely show. Just do it.
I'm going to make a collect call.
1-800-COLLECT presents Ava Save-A-Lot. Torture.
Careful how you dial, boys.
Ava, we always use 1-800-COLLECT.
Then you already know it saves at least a buck or two.
Of course. It's so easy.
I thought you had a call to make.
Talk about saving some dough.
1-800-COLLECT. Save a buck or two.
Oh, come on. You can't stay another day.
Stay.
There he is.
I wish I could. I'm just so crazed with the new job. I don't have time to figure out my finances.
We went through the same thing when we got this house. And with the new baby coming, we need his help.
So what'd you guys do?
Called T. Rowe Price.
Really?
Yeah, it was great. It really helped simplify things. Give him a call.
Yeah, I will.
What a big brother's for, right? Come on, get out of there, you.
Bye.
Bye.
T. Rowe Price, helping people invest with confidence for over 60 years.
Hi, this is Luis Gonzalez of the Arizona Diamondbacks. We appreciate everything you guys are doing down there fighting for our country. We hope everybody has a safe and happy holidays, and we can't wait to get you guys home. And to us athletes, you guys are the true heroes. Thank you.
Welcome back to the top 10 games. Drama in Game 5 of the World Series. Byung-Young Kim trying to close out a 2-0 lead for the Diamondbacks, bottom of the ninth. But for the second night in a row, Scott Brosius tags Byung-Young Kim the game-tying two-run homer, ties it at two. We go into extra innings. Top of the 12th, bases loaded, one out for Arizona. Mariano Rivera in. Facing Reggie Sanders. Up the middle, Alfonso Soriano will get his man. Arizona would not score. Chuck Knobloch at second with one out. It's Soriano this time at the plate, and he would play Chuck Knobloch. The Yankees win at 3-2 in 12 for a 3-2 World Series lead.
the conclusion of Game 5 was astounding. Two runs down, two outs, bottom of the ninth, as Dan just told you, Brocious. Just four hits in 24 World Series at-bats, clubs a homer off of Byung-Hung Kim to tie it. But what made Game 5 so remarkable, so incomprehensible, was that we had just seen it all the night before in Game 4. Tim Kirchin recalls that night for our Game Number 6.
It was one for the ages. It was one for all ages. It was one of the greatest World Series games of all time. It had everything: controversy, intrigue, elation, heartbreak, multiple second-guess opportunities, courageous pitching, great defense, and a stirring God Bless America. It had a critical play at the plate and a finish never before seen in the history of the World Series. A game-tying home run in the ninth inning, a game-winning homer in the tenth.
Sanders back to the wall, and it is gone! A home run! The Yankees have won it!
It was so good, 2 months were needed to complete it. The game started in October, and 3.5 hours later ended in November. The only baseball game ever played on Halloween night forever could haunt the Diamondbacks. The Yankees were one out away from not just losing the game, but perhaps the series and their dynasty. Down 2-1 in the series, they trailed 3-1 going to the ninth inning. Only twice in World Series history, in 1911 and 1929, had the home team won a game that had trailed by 2 runs after 8 innings. But these are the Yankees. And it's never over until they say so, especially in their house. Their leader, Paul O'Neill, perhaps playing his final season, singled softly with one out in the ninth off 22-year-old Byung-Hung Kim. With two out, another charter member of this dynasty, Tino Martinez, who might be playing his last season as a Yankee, got his first hit of the series.
Finley going back, it is gone! A home run! He's tied the game!
With two out in the tenth, Derek Jeter, the only man to bat in a World Series game in November, homered at 12:04 a.m. for a miraculous 4-3 win. Kim became the third youngest reliever to lose a World Series game and the youngest since his pitching coach, Bob Welch, lost in 1978 against the Yankees. Jeter became Mr. November. This year's Mr. October, Curt Schilling, started for the Diamondbacks, one of the most fascinating, most debated decisions in World Series history. Schilling was pitching on less than full rest for the second time in his career. Bob Brenly, Arizona's fearless manager, was going for the knockout, but critics wondered why, with a series lead, would he push a guy who had never been pushed? Schilling answered with 7 brilliant innings. He wanted to pitch longer, but Brenly said no. Schilling was a hero and was being saved for Game 7. Brenly's decision to pull Schilling after 88 pitches will be argued for years. This game will be discussed for years. It will forever be known as Game 4, 2001, the night the Yankees came back, the Diamondbacks lost, and the World Series produced another unforgettable classic.
Ahead as the countdown continues, where does the fantastic finish that gave the Diamondbacks the World Series fit into the top 10?
And it seemed every Duke-Maryland game played came down to the wire last year. Which ending made our list of fantastic finishes?
Intelligent nightlife. Be smart. Drink responsibly.
Singular Wireless, supporting self-expression nationwide.
Every day, Ameridebt helps more people with money problems.
My credit card debt was outrageous. Then I called Ameridebt. They contacted my creditors and got my payments almost cut in half.
Ameridebt is a nonprofit organization that offers free consultations to consumers seeking to eliminate their debt.
Every month I pay our credit card bills, but the balances never seem to get smaller.
Ameridebt got our interest rates reduced.
and now the balances are dropping dramatically.
Call 1-800-554-9000. Ameridebt, helping America get out of debt.
ESPN and NFL Films presents NFL's Greatest Games.
Has recovered.
As soon as that fumble occurred, it was over.
The 87 Browns Broncos AFC Championship, the fumble.
You are one game away from the Super Bowl.
The 92 Cowboys Niners NFC Championship, the changing of the guard.
When Alvin makes one of the great catches in the history of the NFL in a championship game.
We had what we wanted, a shot to play for the Super Bowl.
NFL's Greatest Games, 8 o'clock Christmas night on ESPN.
Game number 5, Women's National Championship, Battle of Indiana. Notre Dame up 1 point on Purdue in the second half with a minute and a half to go. And Katie Douglas, the Purdue All-American, and one, puts Purdue up 66-64. With a minute to go, Notre Dame sends it down to Ruth Riley, the All-American, who wound up being the Final Four's most outstanding player. Ties the game at 66, and with 7 seconds to go, she's fouled down low. Afterwards, Riley said it was fitting the Battle of Indiana came down to an ending reminiscent of a scene from the movie Hoosiers. When the little kid Ollie made 2 free throws for the win, Riley said, "I didn't have to underhand them, though." She puts the Irish up 2 with their free throws. Purdue's inbounds the length of the court, and it's Katie Douglas from 18 feet for the tie. No good, and Notre Dame gets his first national title. A perfect segue to our collection of fantastic finishes from throughout the year. Most of the games themselves don't rate on our top 10 meter, but their final moments deserve a bit of the spotlight.
So among those you will not be seeing, the Heat's 95-56 loss to the Jazz December 18th, the Cubs' 20-1 win over the Dodgers May 5th, the Hurricanes' 59-0 shutout of Syracuse November 17th, or September 30th, Chiefs 45, Redskins 13. What you will see is something we think is very special.
Celtics looking for a miracle. Nets just trying to hold on. Knocked away. Thrown up. And good! Good! Incredible! Absolutely incredible at the buzzer.
The 0-1 pitch. Swinging a fly ball. Shallow left field. O'Leary coming in. He's there. He's calling. And Hideo Nomo has pitched a no-hitter.
Lang drops it back. Here comes Casper. And he scores!
Chance. Williams down the lane.
Messina was just one strike away from a perfect game.
He knew it. David Toms has won the PGA.
Matthews has the snap. He's back. He looks. He's getting pressure. He's going down into the end zone for the ball, and it is knocked in the air, and it is nipped and caught by Chicago. He throws it, deflected in the air, and it's intercepted again, and he goes in for a touchdown, and it is Mike Brown for the second week in a row.
St. Pierre drops back, throws left side, hit, and into the hands of Matt Walker. He intercepts it, brings it across the 15, the 20, and Reed takes the ball on an exchange, brings it over the 40, 50, down the middle. It's a race for 30, for 20. Reed is going to score for Miami. The Hurricanes are going to win this game.
still up a preposterous moment. The U.S. Open moment that put the guh and goose in the paw and Brooks and the hole in sync.
And we're not done with the World Series. There's still the matter of Game 7 we have to address.
I couldn't wait to show off my new wheels at the reunion until I told my State Farm agent I really needed it fixed fast, and he mentioned Service First.
When you choose State Farm Service First claims program, you don't have to get estimates. You go straight to a participating repair center with a guarantee their work. It's as simple as that.
I was looking good again in no time.
Ronnie?
Service First. Just one more way. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Remember that feeling of having to stay inside the lines? It's sort of like communicating on the internet today. Now imagine an internet service that lets you fully express yourself. Break the boundaries with AT&T WorldNet Service Plus. After all, why just send a typeface when you can send your face with video email? And with the most reliable connections, our instant messaging and chat will keep you connected. Plus, you can get web access by phone free until March, so you can check your emails from anywhere. All from the internet service named Best ISP by PC World. And all for just $16.95 a month, nearly 30% less than AOL. Now get 1 month free when you sign up for AT&T WorldNet service. So call 1-800-WORLDNET today and kiss ordinary ISPs goodbye. AT&T WorldNet Service Plus. Pretty hot, huh?
I'll weigh nothing, and I like John. But my 7-year-old could have scored against that soft coverage.
You're saying Elway went 98 yards because the Browns, what, play to prevent defense?
That's exactly what I'm saying. Sterling, I don't think so.
I played in the game. It was a great drive. Why are you dissing Elway anyway?
No reason. But what are you going to do about it?
Knock it off, Sterling.
Knock it off.
Come on, why don't you cry about it? Come on, why don't you cry
Sterling,
about it?
Sterling, do it again.
Game 4 in our countdown of the year's top 10 takes us to Tulsa, Oklahoma, site of golf's United States Open, and site of one of the most improbable finishes to a golf event you could imagine. Retief Goosen would eventually leave the Southern Hills Country Club as the Open champ, defeating Mark Brooks in an 18-hole playoff on Monday, June 18th. But it was what happened on the day before on the 18th hole that caught our eye and took the player's breath away. Scott Van Pelt reports.
You know, the main thing I was trying to do was find the line. So I probably didn't pay enough attention to the speed. Obviously, I hit it too hard. And now I think I picked the right line. If I'd hit it softer, I think it'd have been the right direction.
That was nerve-wracking, the putt for birdie. How about the putt for par?
I didn't hit it hard enough, and I think if I'd hit it harder, I'd have missed right it. I think it would actually would have stayed up on the right. That green did look slow, and you know, I was kind of having to putt, start it up the hill. You know, my putt was one, you know, probably 50-50, and you know, I probably overplayed the break, but the greens, you know, it's a little slower than the rest of the greens, so that's probably a contributing factor.
Brooks's hopes apparently were dashed as he watched Retief Goosen's spectacular approach into the 72nd hole of the championship. But to his and everyone else's amazement, the 18-hole chaos was just getting started.
The first putt, you know, I thought that was my important one. And I hit the ball right where I wanted to. It looked like it was going to go in and just stop breaking at the last few feet. And after that, I thought it was my civic duty, I guess, to go ahead and putt out because Retief had a 10-footer uphill for a 2-putt to win. So I went ahead and I putted out. I found it really very difficult to focus there on that next one coming back just because I didn't really think it meant that much. You know, I wasn't trying to finish second or third or tied with anybody. I was trying to finish first.
Yeah, I figured it was over. No question. And it probably should have been.
What I thought on the first putt, you know, this is going to be slow putting up the hill. When I hit it, I knew I just hit it a little bit too hard, and it ran 3 feet past.
Well, he's got enough energy to light up the city of Napa, where I live right now, I can tell you that, and that showed in that putt.
Seeing what happened to Stewart's third putt breaking so much right, you know, I saw my putt coming back just off center right. I was quite surprised to see the putt going back to the right, coming back. If anything, we expected it to go left, me and Greg. So, anyway, you know, we just knocked the third one in and give ourselves another chance tomorrow.
The first thing I thought was I was just shocked that he put himself in that situation. Never really even crossed my mind until we were walking off the green that I had just, in effect, lost out in being a playoff. You know, because like I said, my important putt was the first one. The second one was inconsequential to me, I thought.
Stewart, he's going to be upset with what happened to him in the last. He was trying to win it, he didn't win it, I was trying to win it, I didn't win it. Mark also made bogey in the last hole, so he thought his chances was gone. This game, it's never over till it's over.
If you put Retief Goosen on that green and give him 100 putts, he's going to get in two shots 75 times out of 100. And the other 25, he's going to make it in one.
Embarrassing, it's humiliating, it's all those things. It's kind of about the only shot that we play that, you know, average Joe out there that plays, you know, once or twice a week thinks he can handle, you know, two footer. And sometimes, you know, weird things happen.
Still up, on paper it was an average college football game. On the field it was a 4-hour, 14-minute thriller that produced 16 touchdowns and 7 overtimes.
And in the World Series that produced 7 games, these two men gave New York a dose of its own. Forget about it.
The bow. Resistance becomes strength. Becomes power. The power to change and reshape your entire body. This is Bowflex, an entire gym in one easy-to-use machine. So powerful, it delivers over 60 health club quality exercises with up to 410 pounds of resistance in any room in your home. Strength training with Bowflex is so effective that we guarantee you'll get the results you want in 6 weeks or less. One simple workout. 20 minutes a day, 3 days a week. Bowflex is real. The results are real. And you can own one with no money down and payments as low as $33 per month. Call right now for a free video and brochure. Bowflex, the power is yours.
The yellow one is Pikachu. He's a Pokemon.
Yeah, who is Digimon?
Digimon is like a different group, wholly separate from the Pokemons.
Thanks for clarifying that.
Sure. Actually, Digimon means digital monsters.
Have yourself a SportsCentury Christmas.
We got a brouhaha here.
See over 24 straight hours of SportsCentury shows from this award-winning series on ESPN Classic.
Nobody better.
Watch the ones you missed. Don't miss the ones you watch.
That's me.
Career highlights, careers in twilight.
I couldn't believe it.
Who they were in a different light. The Christmas SportsCentury Marathon runs tonight and all day tomorrow only on ESPN Classic. To get ESPN Classic, call 1-800-CLASSIC now.
Camry. One look, and you're gonna want one.
Our friends at ESPN.com have their own thoughts on the past year in sports. Make sure to log on and see what images and stories impacted riders like Jim Capel, Ralph Wiley, and Bill Simmons. Plus, they'll unveil their un-sportsman of the year.
The nation's best college basketball team keeps playing great games, great finishes. January 27th, Duke down by 8. Jason Williams says Duke is down 5. 45 seconds to go. Williams with a 3 on the break. Duke is down just 2. Tied at 90, Maryland's last chance, Drew Nicklaus from the corner, and we go into overtime. In overtime, Maryland down 2 with the ball, and Juan Dixon blocked by Shane Battier. Duke wins in overtime. December 18th, Duke down against Kentucky. Off the miss, Jason Williams will take it the other way to tie this ball game. 1:22 to go, and it's Williams again, proving why he's the best player in college basketball. Hits the 3, Duke by 2. But this game would go into overtime. In overtime, Williams and the foul. Up 2 with 10 seconds to play. Off the Mike Dunleavy miss. Dante Jones, the rebound, the putback. Williams and Duke win.
It is the beauty of this endeavor that amidst the championship games or playoff games or tournament games and matches that usually comprise our list, we frequently find one normal, run-of-the-mill, regular season contest that, at game time, offered no indication something special and historic was about to happen. On November 3rd, the game between unranked 4-3 Arkansas at unranked 6-1 Ole Miss was such a game. Number 3 on our list, a 7 overtime thriller, as recalled by those who witnessed it.
Worried about 1 or 2 overtimes. Never in my wildest dreams did I think about 7.
Well, the first overtime is just, you know, natural procedure.
The give is to Cobbs. Cobbs at the 10. Cobbs at the 5. Touchdown!
I'm feeling okay right there. I'm feeling okay. But again, they still have Eli Manning.
Waiting for the snap. There it is. Here comes pressure. Manning looking to throw into the end zone. Touchdown! Armstead!
It's going to be a lot of ups and downs in there. It's going to be some crazy plays.
And a sack from behind. He causes a fumble at Arkansas coming up with it.
We just knew right then the game was over. I knew we won the ball game.
O'Donohoe, 35 yards for the win.
There's no doubt in my mind.
The kick is on its way, and it is no good. Oh, my.
The man upstairs, he's trying to tell us something. Let's go out here and make this happen.
And the drama continues here in Oxford, Mississippi.
It just kept going. It's like, you know, a never-ending story.
I said, okay, guys. Called them all up right then. I said, hey, we're going to be here a while now. Come on, let's play.
Jones is at the 15, the 20, down to the 10, the 5, touchdown!
We were feeling like they couldn't stop us.
But I had no idea what was getting ready to happen for the next 4 or 5 overtimes.
Big back, quick pass over the middle, all alone, touchdown, Flower!
At that point, you're like, man, how crazy could this get?
I was so exhausted that, I mean, I was just trying to make it to the next play.
Felt like we were playing all day.
You're running out of thoughts and ideas as a coach.
Rolling out, Matt Jones. Jones now in trouble. Jones, it is good! Complete in the back of the end zone. And we are headed to number 7.
It was unreal that it was 50-50 in the 7th overtime when in the regulation it was 17-17.
I saw a burst of energy right there after that when we tied it.
Jones rolling back. Jones in trouble. Throws over the middle. It's good! It's complete for 2!
Call it the defense, oversight defense. Gotta have you.
I was praying the whole time that our defense would stop them.
You're down there praying. You know, everyone's full of emotion.
I'm biting my fingernails and I'm thinking, come on, defense.
Something's gotta happen right here. Someone's gonna make a play. Someone's gonna make a mistake. The game's gotta end somehow.
58-56. Manning rolling out. Manning looking, throwing over the middle, and it's Arkansas wins! The 2-point conversion falls short, and the Hogs race on the field in the longest overtime game in the history of 1A college football.
It was kind of heartbroken, you know, just kneeling down there and knowing that it was me that got stopped on the last play of the game. It was unreal that I made the final play to end the game.
I'm looking to the referee because I don't have a full view. I don't know if he's made it. I'm still thinking, are you sure this game's over?
My adrenaline just made me run 100 yards, and you know, after playing 7 overtimes, I shouldn't have had enough energy to run that far, but I mean, I was on a dead sprint.
I didn't feel a lot of pain or sadness at that point in time.
because I don't think I had much emotion left in me to feel anything.
Physically, our bodies were not ready for that kind of environment.
I'm proud so much of the effort, the gladiator-type spirit that just refused to give up, refused to lose, and a place where Arkansas has been really never been successful in Oxford, Mississippi.
From the drama of seven overtimes to the drama of a game seven, a conclusion to the World Series that we won't soon forget.
Holiday greetings from Budweiser. Family to yours, we wish you a very safe and happy holiday season.
Ocean's 11 is the coolest. Pure fun. It's contagious. Two thumbs up.
You're either in or you're out.
Ocean's 11, rated PG-13. Now play.
I'm a mama's boy. I pity the fool who ain't one. Mama misses you. So when you call her collect, dial 1-800-COLLECT. It'll save her a buck or two. Mama loves saving me with 1-800-COLLECT. 1-800-COLLECT, save a buck or two.
You know, ideas and inventions come from people in all walks of life. Do you have an idea for a new product or invention? If so, Invention Submission Corporation has information to help you get started. ISC is America's largest inventor service firm. Call now and learn how to submit your idea to companies through ISC's data bank and apply for a patent. Even if your idea is just to improve an existing product, call for ISC's free information.
For your free inventor's information, call 1-800-554-9000.
A special airing of Dick's Chat, flashing before my eyes.
I'm often asked what my favorite sport is, and I always say, people. I collect people.
Tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern on ESPN.
Hi, this is Jason Giambi of the New York Yankees. I just want to wish the troops a happy holidays.
Down to just two games left in our top 10, and for game number two, we turn to game number seven of the World Series. After crushing losses in New York, the Diamondbacks returned to Arizona and pounded the Yankees 15-3 in game six. So game seven set up a classic showdown, Schilling versus Clemens, Pinstripes versus Pools. And the greatest close of the postseason is ever seen, unable to close the only game seven he's ever pitched in the major leagues. Curt Schilling was the man for the Diamondbacks, his third start of the series. The opposition, Roger Clemens, the American League Cy Young winner. Top of the first, one out, Paul O'Neill. Into the right center field gap, Danny Bautista will track it down after the ricochet off the wall. The key throw is the relay throw. A perfect strike to Craig Counsell, and then his throw to Matt Williams. Schilling gets out of the first, allowing no runs. Bottom of the first, one on and two outs, and it's Clemens facing Matt Williams. A 21-pitch inning for Clemens, but still scoreless. Still scoreless, bottom of the third. Clemens facing Tony Womack. One of 10 Ks on the night for the Rocket. Still no score, top of the sixth. Schilling dominating as well, facing Alfonso Soriano, his seventh strikeout victim. Next batter is Scott Brosius. Goes down swinging on the splitter, eighth strikeout for Schilling. Bottom of the sixth, the leadoff man is Steve Finley. Base knock to center field, the first leadoff man to reach base in the game. Next hitter is Danny Bautista. Into left center, and Finley is going to motor all the way around to score. Bernie Williams will find Derek Jeter on the relay. Jeter makes the acrobatic relay to nail Bautista at third, but Arizona breaks through, leading it 1-0. In the seventh, 2-1, one out, Tino Martinez with a base knock off Schilling. Jeter scores and we're tied at one. Two batters later, two outs, it's Shane Spencer at the plate. He lines one to right center, but Steve Finley got a great jump on it. Schilling would get out of the inning. We're tied at one. One out, bottom of the seventh, Tony Womack. Solid base hit to right field, and that would be it for Roger Clemens. The Rocket goes 6 1/3 and leaves with a tie ball game. Mike Stanton on, Womack at first. Craig Counsell swings and misses. Womack goes on the delayed steal, and Jorge Posada gets his man. Posada and the Yanks get out of the inning, tied at one.
Splitter, there's a long high drive, deep in the left center field. Gonzalez way back, and it is gone, a home run!
Alfonso Soriano gives the Yankees a 2-1 lead. Schilling left two batters later, allowing two runs in seven and a third, eight Ks. Randy Johnson in relief. Gets Chuck Knobloch to fly out to right to end the inning. 2-1 Yankees lead. New York turns to its closer, Mariano Rivera. Possible two-inning save. Dominating the eighth, strikes off Bautista to end the inning. Striking out the side. So we go to the bottom of the ninth. Yankees up 2-1. Mark Grace facing Rivera. Base knock to center. Pinch runner is David DeLucci at first. Damian Miller tries the sacrifice bunt. Rivera fields it, throws to second, but the throw is wide. Both runners are safe on the error. So first and second, nobody out. The pinch hitter is Jay Bell. The perfect bunt. Rivera hops on it, throws to third, and gets the lead runner, DeLucci, one out. Next batter, Tony Womack. Down the right field line, pinch runner Midrick Cummings is going to tie this game at two. Runners at second and third after Womack's double. Next hitter, it's Craig Counsell. And Rivera plunks him to load the bases. So the Yankees would bring in the infield looking for the potential force out at home.
And a little Cooper. Space hit! Diamondbacks win! They're the world champions! Gonzalez did it! The Diamondbacks have unseated! The New York Yankees are the world champions!
The pitch is swung on and blew to center field. That's a base hit! And Arizona will win the World Series! Bell scores! Arizona wins!
You can't measure the determination, the heart, and the pride that we played the game with. And every guy that went to the plate in that inning, I knew, believed he was going to win the game for us.
This was an exciting World Series to watch, I'm sure. Gut-wrenching for the players and the staff and stuff, but the bottom line is we came out on top, and we'll take it.
It's been pretty fortunate, you know, to get the chance 4 years in a row, you know, to be in the World Series. You know, it's the first taste of being on the other side of it. It's not nearly as fun.
With the win, the Diamondbacks became the fastest expansion franchise to win the World Series. It was also the first championship for the city of Phoenix in the four major sports teams. Curt Schilling, who pitched three terrific games in the series, and Randy Johnson, who won three games in the series, shared MVP honors.
Our top game isn't a game, it's a reaction to the events of September 11th, which shocked all of us in a way we never thought possible. And the sports world found itself reevaluating its place and significance in our society.
And while we all agree the attacks helped put sports in their proper perspective, the athletes of the sporting world also gave us new perspective on their resolve, their dedication, and their oft-questioned character. Bob Lee has more.
Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate...
No one anywhere was immune from the attacks of September 11th.
One of my brothers was in the building. So... he's all right, though, but... he got out just in time.
The word hero, so easily given to athletes, suddenly was bestowed, and most appropriately, on those who risked and gave their lives that tragic day. Firefighters, policemen, emergency service workers. The games fell silent.
We come out every single day for the last 8 years, and I've seen two towers stand there. They're not there. There's nobody thinking about football.
It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that sporting events are absolutely meaningless to compare what's going on in Washington and going on in New York.
Major League Baseball, as a social institution, can best be helpful by resuming play at the most appropriate time. I believe that time is Monday.
We in the National Football League have decided that our priorities for this weekend are to pause, breathe, and reflect. It is a time to tend to families and neighbors and all those wounded by these horrific acts of terrorism.
Athletes exhibited a personal and human side so often lost in the fast lane of their celebrity and wealth. hospital visits, blood donations, support for the workers at Ground Zero. Small human gestures.
To come here and be able to, you know, at least take their minds off of the job that they have, and maybe bring, something positive, means so much, because you hear the stories and you can't imagine the things that they're going through right now.
And then, tentatively, but with a new purpose, new rules, and new fears, the games return.
I don't know about you, but as for me, the question has already been answered. Should we be here? Yes.
A shocked and grieving nation felt compelled to express its patriotism. And where better but the ballpark or the football stadium? Pre-game rituals, days before just part of the background noise of sports, assumed a heartfelt importance. The familiar became profound.
One, two, three. God bless America!
God bless America. Land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above.
From the mountains to
the rain.
Once the games resumed, so did their special memories.
The scrimmage, they give us to Edger, looking for a block. Now pitches it back to Payton. Got a man wide open at Payton. The flea flicker works. 30, 25, 20, 50, 10, 5. Touchdown, hold.
Looking into the end zone. Nobody there. He'll win.
Perhaps the most moving was at New York's Shea Stadium, which days before had been a staging area for the fire department of New York. At a ballpark where the words miracle and despair were once adjectives for a team's play, where glitter and celebrity are the norm, there was a new reality. The Twin Towers were memorialized atop the scoreboard. The most bitter of rivals, moved by the occasion, spontaneously embraced before the game. There was star power, both before the game and in the seventh inning stretch. And a final act to top them all.
And it's a deep to left center. Andrew Jones on the run. This one has a chance. Home run! Mike Piazza! And the Mets lead 3-2.
It was a moment to affirm the glory of this game and its power to uplift, if only for a moment, a city and a country struggling to recover in a world that had been changed forever.
There is only one thing to do. Everyone is saying the same thing and praying that we end these senseless moments we are living. As our fathers did before, we shall win this unwanted war. And our children will enjoy the future we'll be giving.
I have two brothers-in-law who are New York City firefighters, and I too was guilty of taking them for granted in what they did on a daily basis. But sad to say that something like this kind of wakes us all up. And Bob talked about the word hero, and we've always affixed that to our favorite athlete. I don't think we're going to be as generous to throw that word towards them when we can throw it towards other people.
Well, I think certainly in light of what happened on September 11th, it gives all of us pause at this moment during the holiday season to celebrate the holiday season and cherish those that we celebrate it with even more. And that's all we can say about that. And
I think Mayor Giuliani said that too. You grieve, but you still have to celebrate. We need to do that. Thanks for joining us on our Top 10 Games.
Happy holidays.